This is definitely a moment to savour. We finally have a bull in the china shop. It's an amazing privilege, especially in Lamborghini's 50th anniversary year, to actually have a Urraco to work on. I totally agree with Mike that we just had to buy this immovable non-runner. But now my challenge starts, because as good as it looks, I need to drive this wonderful supercar. And as always, there is loads of work to do. Engine work is the biggie on this car, and that's going to be my first job. I've got a non-functioning clutch and frayed timing belt, which means that starting the engine now could end up destroying it. Oh, look at that. That is a 2.5-litre Lamborghini V8. And it looks wonderful from the outside, but of course, unfortunately, we know nothing about its history. And before I even dare to start this thing up, I want to know that everything is right. So I'm going to change the cam belts, sort out anything that's wrong with the ignition. In fact, look for anything else that might need to be refurbished or swapped before we fire this little chap into life.
Removing the motor on a mid-engine Lamborghini is at least a day's work, and getting a specialist to do it could cost around £2,000. I'm going to tackle it myself and start at the top by stripping the air filter and electrical connections. Then, down below, I drain the cooling system.
Now, while I've been under here, I think I may have noticed what is causing our clutch problem. If you look along this braided hose here, you can see there's a collection of hydraulic fluid, a little drip at the end there. And if I follow that moisture all the way up the hose, it only seems to go halfway. So we must have a leak kind of halfway along. So I've just got this mirror, as I suspected, just about where the hose touches the chassis. When somebody tried to operate the clutch, it's actually burst. The fluid is leaked out, which is why the clutch pedal goes all the way to the floor without actually operating the clutch itself. So whatever happens, we're going to have to fix that hose.
And that's a job that will come when the engine is out of the car. I disconnect the drive shaft, then work to remove the entire rear subframe, which means the engine and gearbox will exit the car as one unit. As always, the engine needs to be lowered in controlled stages in case any cables or hoses have been missed. After taking this much care, it would be a real shame to damage something. And there she is.
That is fantastic. This is the heart of the beast, and well worth the struggle trying to get it out of the car. Now, that's the engine side, this is the gearbox. I need to sort out the problem with the clutch. Now, we already know that this hose has been leaking. You can see the damage a bit more clearly here. But obviously, this is a specialist part. It is unique to the Lamborghini Urraco, so obviously, it's going to be pretty hard to get hold of one, and I bet you it's going to be expensive. But that's not my problem. I'm going to give that to Mike to sort out, so I need to get it off.
But as I cut through the hydraulic pipe with the help of the saw, I can see that something seems to be missing from the outside of the clutch slave housing. So I dig inside to see what's going on.
It was a kind of a slot, and ordinarily I would expect some kind of spring perhaps to be there to reset the clutch slave every time you actually operate the pedal. So by the looks of it, potentially right down inside the bell housing may well be a spring. The only way to find out about that is to actually take the gearbox off the engine, but don't worry, it's not such a crazy thing to have to do because it's not going to be just for the spring. Also, it makes sense, having gone to all this length to get the engine out of the car, to actually have a look at the condition of the clutch.
So I need to separate the engine from the gearbox. Because of the way I took the power plant out, I now have to strip away the rear subframe, which means unbolting the exhaust, then suspending the block and removing the subframe from underneath.
Well, here we go, moment of truth. We now have our gearbox separated from the engine, and look at that. There is the spring that I was looking for earlier on. Thankfully, it hasn't fallen out through the hole at the bottom there. But I have to say, it's not looking ideal. It looks like some of it's actually corroded and perhaps snapped off, which is obviously why it let go in the first place. I need to fix that. But before I do that, I think I'm gonna crack on and have a little look and see the condition of our clutch.
This car has done 50,000 miles, very low for its age. But high-performance cars like this go through clutches much faster than the average family hatch.
OK, well, I've definitely seen clutches in better condition than this. There's not many miles left on this little chap, so that's going to have to be replaced for sure.
And this moisture-damaged pressure plate is also too far gone.
So Mike really is going to have to be a bit of a busy boy, either getting these replaced or refurbished. But I will help him out. I think I'll fix the spring. Now, while the engine and gearbox are out of the car, it would have been crazy not to spruce them up, and they now look absolutely fantastic on the outside. But the thing is, I now need to do some critical maintenance to make sure that when we turn it over for the first time, the engine remains in tip-top condition on the inside.
I'm talking about replacing the aged cam timing belt. If it were to snap while the engine was spinning, serious damage could be done to the inside of the engine.
To get to those cam belts, I need to take off these little cover plates here, this pipe, and to get all that off, I need to remove the air conditioning pump.
Most aircon systems on cars of this age are removed because they don't work. I'm hoping ours does, so I won't bin it. Either way, before work starts, I've had the system degassed, which is a legal health and safety requirement.
So when the engine's running, the crankshaft is spinning around, moving the pistons up and down inside the cylinders, but also the camshafts are spinning around, opening and closing the valves into the cylinders. Now, there are two types of engine, an interference engine and a safe engine. Now, in a safe engine, the valves and the pistons would never actually meet, even if everything got out of sync. But an interference engine, like this one, unfortunately, the valves and the pistons actually kind of operate in the same space, but at different times. So if something was to happen with the belt and everything got out of sync, then those pistons would just smash the valves a bit, ended up scrapping your engine.
Top tip, before removing any belts, make sure the special markings which identify the pulley positions are aligned. That way, you can be sure all the pulleys are orientated correctly when the new belts go on. Unfortunately, the markings that indicate when the crank is in top dead center position are on the flywheel, and the inspection window is cut into the gearbox, so that has to go back in place.
Okay, so I can see the line. It lines up perfectly with the line on the gearbox. There's the letters PMS, which is actually Italian for top dead center, which is punto morto superiori. There we go.
At last, I can back off the pulley that tensions the belt so it can be prized off.
With the cam belt out of the way, I can now check the bearings on these idler pulleys. I'm just going to spin them up and listen. Now, that's not too bad, really. That sounds like a bad roller skate. That needs to be changed, definitely. Last one here. Slightly quieter, but still needs to be changed. So I might as well change all of them, because that way then I know that all of these bearings are in perfect condition.
Once unbolted, I still need a puller to remove the pulley from the engine. Although most things on the Urraco are difficult to find, these bearings are still a standard size, and I can bag a set for £100. I use a press to separate the old bearing from the pulley. Then I tidy up the pulley by cleaning off the surface corrosion with some emery cloth and oil. Finally, the press is used again to push the new bearings into place.
So that's it. I've now got new bearings in all three of these little idler pulleys. And if I just spin them up, you can hear absolutely nothing, because they're now working perfectly, which is fantastic. So now, when I put the brand new belt on, we know that all of this is going to be working perfectly.
This is the kind of TLC a Lamborghini engine doesn't just need, it deserves. I add the new belt, rotate the engine a couple of times, and make sure our marks still line up, which they do. And before I get the engine back together, I'll perform a full service, including swapping plugs, distributor cap and leads, and air filters. And I don't get a break after all that because a parcel has arrived from Mike. I've got a new clutch cover, clutch bearing and slave cylinder, and a refurbished clutch plate. He tells me the price tally for this lot is a rather horrific $2,500. At least the hydraulic pipe that Mike commissioned is a more modest £25. Although it took an age to remove the engine, with everything on the bench, in less than 2 hours, I managed to reassemble the clutch complete with replacement spring.
Right, so now everything to do with the clutch is now sorted. So all I've got to do is pop the gearbox back onto the engine into the subframe, and then the subframe wanged into the car. Fantastic.
I'm desperately hoping that after all this work, our Lamborghini will start. If it doesn't, it could prove to be our biggest mistake ever. Mr. Brewer has promised he'll arrive for the grand ceremony, when we'll see for the first time whether our engine will actually run.
Yes! Good lads! That is awesome!
Such a relief! I can't tell you how good I feel at the moment. Wow! OK, well, you just got to finish it off now.
Yeah.
Click here to subscribe.